This guy needs a coach. If only Jim Baker were Secretary of State today. Someone who could say to him what he used to say to Bandar, which is, sit your royal ass down here and I'm going to have a talk with you. He needs a coach, and he does not have a coach, I believe, in the region. He's fighting 18 different battles at once, and he needs a coach, and his coach is Donald Trump. What can I say? Bruce.
It's pretty hard to top that. Like Tom, I also began my career at the CIA back in the late 1970s. I was the Saudi desk officer on 1979 during the mosque takeover. No country has ever done as much economic damage to the United States as Saudi Arabia has. Not the Soviets, not the Nazis, nobody. Saudi Arabia has done more economic damage to us than any other country. And there have other been very low moments. I call them near-death experiences in the book. There was a near-death experience at the in the Obama administration over the Arab Spring, particularly over the Arab Spring in Bahrain, where the Saudis came close to the point of saying, we're going to use oil as a weapon again. If you look at the relationship today, I think there's a paradox. Superficially, it's better than ever. Donald Trump famously made Riyadh his first visit. He was dined. He wasn't wined, but he was definitely dined. He was flattered. I would say the Saudis understood their man, their coach, and they played him like a fiddle. They promised a lot, including a $110 billion arms deal, which is fake news. There is no $110 billion arms deal. If you ask the Department of Defense what's in it, they can't answer the question. But they promised him a lot, and he gave them a very blank check endorsing their policies, particularly their policies vis-a-vis Iran and their policies in Iran. And he's followed up on that blank check with a series of tweeted blank checks since then, supporting everything that the Crown Prince and his father is doing. In that sense, the relationship looks really good. But if you look a little bit more closely, the relationship's got some serious problems. Number one is in the judicial branch. The Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act passed last year in a veto override by the Senate, 98-0, allows plaintiffs to sue Saudi Arabia for its involvement, alleged or real, in the 9/11 conspiracy. There are now 7 major court cases underway. What's interesting in these court cases is, as the gutter dispute developed, the plaintiffs began to realize that the UAE could also be sued, and that, in fact, the case can be made better against the UAE than it can against the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. So now both of them are being sued in these court cases. I don't know how these court cases are going to turn out. They'll probably take years. But I think there's a reasonable chance that a judge will find against the Saudis, in which case there will be a massive economic penalty against Saudi Arabia. But there's a contradiction between the Crown Prince's commitment to reform and change and his foreign policy. His foreign policy is very un-Saudi. He doesn't write checks. He intervenes. He tries to use Saudi military force to effect change, most notably in Yemen. And it's not working. Again, as Tom said, they don't have the instruments to do it. The Royal Saudi Air Force can deliver a lot of ordnance, but it can't really change the dynamics of the war in Yemen. Now, those dynamics are very much in flux today, literally as we meet. There's now a new civil war within the civil war. We'll see whether that plays out to the Saudis' benefit or not. We can talk about that in question. But what it comes down to is a country that desperately needs to be spending its money on economic reforms at home is spending an enormous amount of money on its defense budget. The Yemen war, by one conservative estimate, costs Saudi Arabia $200 million a day. Saudi Arabia in 2015, the last year we have good numbers for, had the third largest defense budget in the world. Only the United States and China spent more money on defense in 2015. Now, for Americans, when you do that on a per capita basis, that's that much of a hit. For Saudis, it's $7,000 per person per year on military expenditures with very, very little proof that they're getting anything from it. What they urgently need to do is get out of these quagmires and concentrate on domestic reform at home. That's where Mohammed bin Salman can actually make his mark. Last thing I would say, if you look at the rivalry between the Iranians and the Saudis today across the region, there's one clear winner. The Iranians are cleaning their clock. Now, they've had a little help from us. We opened the door for their potential to get into Iraq. Arguably, we opened the door for their potential, or we facilitated the door in Syria. But objectively, across the region, it is the Saudis who are losing in all of these conflicts, with possible exception of Bahrain. And that's one of the reasons why the Saudis are increasingly desperate and looking for some kind of outside assistance, because they know their clock is being cleaned.
What are Saudis' expectations from Israel?
You know, I would just say, and I'm anxious to see what Bruce says too, you know, when I first started going to Saudi Arabia in the 90s, you know, you couldn't go to a private home, and the first thing on the table was, you know, Israelis and Palestinians. First question. And today you can't go to a private home and the first question isn't red wine or white wine. Okay. I was there for three days. I didn't hear that. I just didn't hear the Israel-Palestine thing come up at all. And I tried to engage him on that. He wouldn't bite. There is one caution, though, I would have for my Israeli friends. And that is, I saw Steinitz last week talking about how we're talking to Saudi Arabia. And that is just really stupid, okay? I have to tell you, for any Israeli minister to talk publicly about Israel's relations with Saudi Arabia is just bloody stupid, because all Hezbollah needs is to take that, and Iran to take that, and say all that Mohammed bin Salman is doing by the way of domestic reform and regional policy is at the behest of the Yehudis. And then you just pound that and pound that and pound that. So if Israelis, you know, have any interest in seeing his reforms succeed, how about shutting up? You know, I know that's hard, but I think that that would be my best advice. You're not doing him any favor to get a headline out on that. But I think more broadly, I think there is an illusion. I've been to this illusion before. I did the Arab Peace Initiative with King Abdullah. And that is that Saudi Arabia is going to do things for Israel for less than the price of real progress on the ground with Palestinians. That is a carpet I have seen sold so many times. And trust me, it's not going to happen. So I lived in Beirut for years 5 through 10 of the Lebanese Civil War. It was resolved after year 14 in Taif, Saudi Arabia, in an agreement known as the Taif Agreement. And it was based on this principle: no victor, no vanquished, and the minority gets overrepresented. I believe we need a Taif agreement in Syria. I believe we need a Taif agreement in Iraq. Okay, anyone who thinks Iraq cannot be governed without Iran. It cannot be governed by Tehran. But there's got to be some power-sharing arrangement. And what I worry is that this line of making Iran the implacable foe. And I have no illusions about these guys, but they are on the ground and they know how to play the game. And we can break a lot of picks trying to wipe them out of power from Yemen to Syria to Iraq. And at some point, they at least have to be tested whether they can be a partner for some kind of power sharing arrangements in these countries. Because if we think one side, if we take sides in the grand Sunni-Shia civil war, I think that's gonna not end well. And so, again, I have no illusions about the Iranians, but I have no illusions about some of these Sunni powers as well. At the end of the day, the only way these places are going to be stabilized is no victor, no vanquished, and we figure out the proper power-sharing arrangement. But if we think we're going to defeat them, you know, I was the first reporter on the scene when the Marines were blown up in Beirut. I've been to that play. You know, these guys, they play this game so much better than we do. Actually, Israel needs an American coach right now to help it out of its predicament in Syria as much as MBS, you know, needs a coach at home.
I wonder if we fall back to our irredeemable optimism whenever a movement like Arab Spring or a charismatic shmoozy leader like Erdogan challenges the status quo that we loathe, we become too optimistic and excited. Mm-hmm. What makes you think when this young charismatic guy puts his royal butt on his throne, completely unchallenged, his opposition is crushed, mm-hmm. that he will prove to all of us that he is worse off than what he's going to be replaced?
I got news for you. The entire Arab world is dysfunctional right now, completely dysfunctional. And I think it has the potential to be a giant Yemen, a giant human disaster area.
What should our coach be saying? First, restore cohesion in the royal family. There is tremendous hostility among other royals to this young man, who they see as, yes, he's a reformer, but he's brash, he's ruthless, he's breaking the rules, and that he needs a comeuppance. And that is not a good place for him to be, particularly if his father passes away sometime in the near future. As one American official said to me, the father provides air cover for Mohammed bin Salman right now. You take that air cover away, and a lot of the royal family is going to move against this man. And there's no political way to move against him. There's only one precedent for removing a sitting king, and that was King Saud. It took Prince Faisal 10 years to do it, and it came at the end at the barrel of a gun. Literally, the royal palace was surrounded by the National Guard with the tanks' barrels pointing at it, and he was told, you either leave or we're going to kill you. And in the case of this one, a lot of Saudis that I've talked to say, if the king dies tonight, the crown prince could be assassinated before morning. I'm sure he's aware of that. Second advice I would give to him is find a way out of Yemen. Yemen doesn't feature large on our portfolio. It falls back behind Syria and Iraq for understandable reasons. For Saudis, this is the principal war. This is the principal area of conflict. They need a way out of this, and I think the Taif formula is exactly the right formula. We should be looking for a way out of this. The whole world should be looking for a way out of this. We've been on stage here for 42 minutes. Four Yemeni children have died in that time period of diseases that are easily cured. 11 million Yemeni children will be stunted by what has already happened in this war. This is a moral humanitarian catastrophe of enormous proportions. And it means that 28 million Yemenis will spend the rest of their lives trying to find a way to get back at Saudi Arabia. So we need to help them find a way out of this.
How does the Saudis see it from your point of view?
The Saudis invested a lot in Sisi. In fact, I make the case in the book that they are the co-conspirator in the coup that brought him to office. And as a footnote, the leader of that conspiracy was Prince Bandar. It was probably his last big hurrah in the world of
conspiracies.
Conspiracies. A man who's an expert at conspiracy, this was his last big hurrah. But the Yemen war has damaged that relationship too, as you say. The Saudi expectation 30 months ago was that the Saudi and UAE Air Force would be defending an Egyptian and Pakistani ground force moving on Sana'a. The Egyptians said, been there, done that, no thanks. And the Pakistanis, who haven't been there, said no as well. And it was really remarkable. Saudi Arabia has given more aid to Pakistan than any other country in the world. And yet the Pakistani parliament voted unanimously against sending troops to Yemen. This whole long conspiracy that we've heard about, a Saudi-Pakistan nuclear arrangement, well, the Saudis found out the answer. Forget it. Whatever promise you think you have, when the moment of truth comes, we're not going to deliver. These are two vital alliances for the Saudis, Egypt and Pakistan. They've both been severely damaged by the Yemen war, and that's Mohammed bin Salman's judgment.